Hello, everybody. Again, welcome to the second hour. So, as I promised, I'll first finish the proof of this easy theorem of Kirby that class S is compact in the space of analytic functions Nd. And for this, we'll use Montel. So we just saw that for each function f, we can find two points which are emitted by their image, and one of them should be on the unit circle, second one should be on the circle of radius 2. Let us consider this standard transform, which would map an to 0 and bn to 1. Then this an composed with fn would indeed map d to c minus 0, 1, infinity. So the family an fn is normal by Montel. And we can select the convergence subsequence, nk converges with fnk. Bypassing to even further subsequences as usual, we can make sure that ank converges to a and bnk converges to b. And a and b are different numbers because a lies on the unit circle, b lies on the circle of radius 2. And now a and k converges to the corresponding a, so z minus a divided by b minus a. And so from a and k composed with f and k converging to a composed with f, it can take a inverse to see that f and k converges to f, and we are done. So from every sequence, you can select the convergence subsequence. So in a moment, we'll have a much, much stronger theorem, but I just wanted to show you that it can be done by relatively easy methods with no computations, no extremal lengths and so on, just compactness of class S, which implies that all the, again, functionals on S are bounded. And this, so the next theorem shouldn't be, the next theorems should not be too surprising. Okay, so the next thing that I want to do, and here I'll start going a bit slower. This is very classical, but much harder theory of Kirby and Biberbach. So these two people, great mathematicians, not so great people, at least Biberbach, they're authors of this beautiful theory. Again, I assume that some of you have seen it before, but since this is a less standard material, I will go a bit slower. So Kirby-Biberbach theory. The first step, well, it can be done differently. I will stick with very classical approach using what is called Gronwall area theorem. I couldn't find a good picture of Gronwall, an English mathematician. If you have it, I would be grateful if you can send it to me. Okay, so suppose that you have a function from class sigma. Then you have this precise inequality. Sum of n b minus n squared is less or equal than 1. And in a moment, you'll see why this is called area theorem. So basically, because equality is reached when area of complement of the image of the outside of the unit disk under the map F is equal to 0. Okay, but let's go through this slowly. So let R be a number which is bigger or equal than 1. We live outside of the unit disk, remember. Omega R would be what is not in the image of F of RD. So it's a closed set. And gamma R would be its boundary, which is definitely well defined for R bigger than 1. Sometimes, as we will see, it is defined for R equal to 1, but we don't need it. By the standard Green formulas, area of omega r is, well, just this integral w dw. I have two here. And then you can rewrite it in coordinate form. So remember that this f of r a sigma, this is df d theta of r a sigma, d theta rather. And remember this decompositions at infinity. Plug them in, and remember that the integral of, okay, so here, let's print again, sometimes OneNote would forget what I write and randomly delete stuff. Sorry about that. But anyway, by Parseval's theorem, integral fg bar fg is equal to sum of pi sum of a and bn Fourier coefficients. So area of omega r, we just again use this formula. This is p r squared minus sum n b minus n squared divided by r2 to the n. So just okay, green formula plus Parseval identity. And now we let r go to zero to see that area of omega 1 is equal to pi times 1 minus sum n b minus n squared, which would exactly give us this exciting inequality. And equality is achieved when, of course, a of r goes to zero, when area of omega 1 is equal to zero, as we discussed. Okay, so this is the first precise inequality that we would need. Equality is reached here for many functions, for all functions which map to a complement of something which has zero area, in particular for Zhukovsky function. So the main thing we'll need from this Gronwall theorem is very simple estimate. B minus one, the coefficient in front of one over z should be bounded by one. And it's equal to one if and only if f is just shift or rotation of Zhukovsky function z plus one over z. And this is, well, again, equality should be reached only when all the higher coefficients are equal to zero. And indeed, then what is left is just shift and then rotation of Zhukovsky function. So it is extremal for this case. And let me now state the first distortion theorem, which doesn't seem to be that important, but which would lead to all other distortion theorems, that the second coefficient in the expansion of a function from class S is bounded by two, famous theorem of Biberbach. And as I mentioned many times in this course already, in 1984, the branch finally proved, and I should have a picture of the branch here. So he finally proved that N is bounded by N. So Kirby function is indeed extremal for them. Okay, so this is a theorem. And as I mentioned, there are many ways to see it. We'll use, since we just proved Gronwall, let's use Gronwall. More than that, we'll just use this corollary of Gronwall, that B inverse is less or equal than one. And so let G of Z be symmetrization of our function F. So just a tree. We just see that this is one plus A2 over two Z squared plus, et cetera, as we know it's an S. And now let's take corresponding function from sigma. So this is, you know, the heart of this trick. You don't want to take function from sigma, which is one over f of one over z. You want to first take symmetrization, then take this. And then easy calculations show that b minus one coefficient here is a two over two. since we know that this is b minus 1, which is bounded by 1, we immediately get that a2 is bounded by 2. And again, we know what the extremal functions are, which are this of 1 over, which are this are the functions which would produce shifts and rotations of Joukowsky functions. These are just rotations of Kirby function. So we just proved Bieber-Bach's theorem, again using Kronwall. That was not difficult. Let's move on. So the next is, well, again, very classical, very well known, but still very important theorem, that if f is a function of class S, then quarter disk, disk of radius 1/4, is contained in the image of D. So all the functions of class S, they cover this of disk of radius 1/4. And this is again exact, and extremal function is again Kirby function here, because Kirby function, remember, it maps unit disk to the complement of this line from minus 1/4 to minus infinity. The proof is easy. Take W in f of D, consider this exciting function, sorry, W not in f of D, of course. So take W not in f of D. Then let us consider this exciting function. Again, since W is not in f of D, this thing is never zero. So you start expanding it. It's z plus a2 plus 1 over W z squared plus extra terms. And now what do you know? You know that this is bounded by 2. You know that this is bounded by 2, both by Bieber-Bach's theorem. So now you derive from this that 1 over epsilon follow of W is bounded by 4. So, which means that W is at least 1/4. That's it. Okay, so again, what we are doing here, we are showing that just by using Bieber-Bach's theorem, we were able to show precise bound for this maximal disk, which would be bounded, which would be covered by the image of the unit disk. Okay, so now first corollary of this is that if your map is conformal, then as I promised you, distance from f of z to d omega would be between 1/4 times f prime of z 1 minus z squared and 1 times this always. So this bound we have already established. And left hand side, so this bound, take z naught and d, define this function, f of z plus z naught divided by 1 plus z plus z naught minus f z naught. It's a function in S, of course. So this is just application of this transform, tau transform to this. And so if W is not a point in f of d, then W minus f of z naught divided by this, so this is bigger than 1/4, right? Because g is a function in S. So, and I forgot Again, not that I forgot, just again erased it. That, of course, to get back the function from S, you need to divide by this, otherwise you are not in S. But now, again, if W is not an F so Z, then you have exactly this inequality. Just plug it in here, that W minus F of Z not divided. This should be bigger than 1/4. That's it. And here where it disappeared. Sorry. Okay, so this is actually a more useful form of Kirby theorem. Well, it's Kirby together with Schwarz. That precisely distance from the boundary is bounded below by this, bounded above by this. And so another corollary of the corollary, well, that if phi is now a conformal map between two domains, then distance to the boundary divided by phi prime distance from z1 to d omega 1 is between 1/4 and 4. And so you obtain this by going through the unit disk. And so you pick up factors 1/4 and 4 here from the previous inequality. So now, using this, we can define quasi hyperbolic metric. Let me rearrange it a little bit so that it's easier to see. So this is another very important object, quasi hyperbolic metric. And so what we do here, we do the same thing as in hyperbolic metric, but we integrate 1/ distance to the boundary. And what Kirby, well, corollary of Kirby theorem tells us that hyperbolic distance up to a factor of 4 is equal to quasi hyperbolic distance. And again, quasi hyperbolic distance is much, much easier to understand geometrically. And this is a remark for those of you who know what Whitney squares are. This says that Whitney squares are kind of almost invariant. So that's what this corollary does. Okay, now let us try to move further. And I promise you that there will be universal precise bounds on distortion, on the rate of growth of everything. And it starts with the following inequality of Bieber-Bach, that if you have a function in our class S and you have Z with absolute value of R, then this construct is not much different than 2R squared or 1 minus R squared. So the difference is bounded by 4R of 1 minus R squared. And this is very exact. Again, Kirby function is your extremal example and the only extremal examples here in this business. Okay, so the proof is very easy. You just take this transform tau of xi, xi plus z divided by 1 plus z bar xi, and then look at f tau of xi. Remember, this is a function from S. And then it's very easy to compute what a2 is. That's exactly this guy. So this is 1 minus absolute value of z squared, f2 prime of z over f prime of z minus 2z bar. You multiply this inequality by 2 absolute value of z divided by 1 minus z squared, and you get exactly this estimate. So again, you just use f tau trick to obtain the nice estimate. Okay, now let's look at what it gives us what we get here. So let me move it here. So now, why is this useful? Let's observe that the real part of z g prime of z divided by epsilon val of z, this is just the real part of g with respect to r. And the imaginary part of the same thing is derivative of imaginary part of this. Okay, no concern here. F2 prime over f prime is the derivative of log f prime. This actually would be very important in a moment. So derivative of log f prime over the r. So let's okay, so okay, real part. So this is derivative of the real part. It's real part of this z log f prime over epsilon val of z. And so we get that derivative of log, there is not need because I wrote log of absolute value of f prime. So it's real number already. So ddr of log f prime is between this and this. Now, what we do, we integrate it from zero to r to get the following precise theorem. And this is distortion theorem, also by Bieberbach, that derivative at the point z, where z is like here, absolute value of z is equal to r, is bounded between 1 minus r over 1 plus r cubed and 1 plus r over 1 minus r cubed. So we just integrate. Okay, so if we just use, on the other hand, imaginary part, we get this estimate on the derivative of the argument, because imaginary part of the logarithm is argument, right? So we have this estimates on the imaginary part of the logarithm, and we get this rotation theorem, which is very bad. It's extremely, extremely imprecise. So this was the first instance of Kirby-Bieberbach theory not working at all. So the correct precise impression is this. Argument of f prime is bounded by 4 arcsine of r when r is less than 1/4 and pi plus log of r squared over 1 minus r squared when r is bigger than 1 over square root of 2. And the proof actually uses Lerner chains. So the proof is much more complicated. Let me quickly, just for a moment, dwell on why this didn't work. So why we got such an imprecise estimate here? Well, compare this and this. Well, this difference is huge. The reason is the following. It's because Kirby function is no longer extremum. It cannot be extremum. Essentially, it does nothing to the argument. All it does, well, it nicely maps real line to real line. It doesn't rotate anything. The extrema here are obtained on spirals, actually on maps to the spirals. So that's why you need another theory to do this, and we'll briefly touch on this theory when we talk about Loebner maps, Loebner chains. Okay, so now let's integrate these inequalities one more time to get what is now a precise theorem, growth theorem, that absolute value of f of z is bounded by r over 1 minus r squared from above, r of 1 plus r squared from below. To get an estimate from above, well, you don't do anything. You just integrate our precise bound on the derivative. So let me make it slightly more correct. And you get this bound. And again, this is precise because of the Kerber function, but lower bound, which is again achieved on the same Kerber function, you need to be a bit more careful. So let us pick point Z naught on the circle of radius R with the smallest value of absolute value of f of Z naught. So this is the closest point to the zero. Let us look at the segment from zero to Z naught, f of Z naught. It's subset of f of rd. So now let's take gamma, which is pre-image of this segment from zero to f of z naught. It lies inside of rd. Well, let me be very precise here again. It's f of z naught of itself, of course. It lies on rd. So this joins zero to z naught. And so f of z naught, it's just integral over f of gamma dw. Now this is integral over gamma f prime of z dz. And this is bounded by this from below. Right? So we have to integrate over this gamma. So this is f prime of z is bounded by 1 minus z over 1 plus z cubed. And now we simply, okay, so here what I meant to write is from 0 to r, right? Because gamma joins somehow 0 to z naught. So this is bigger than the same integral from 0 to r, and this is exactly r over 1 plus r squared. Okay, so just this technical trick, because otherwise, if you try to integrate over the line from 0 to z naught over straight line, you might not get you would not get the lower bound on f prime. On f res. Okay, and so yet another theorem which would be very useful to us is that ratio of f prime and f is bounded again precisely by 1 minus r over r 1 plus r below and 1 plus r over r and 1 minus r from above. The proof is very similar, but you need to use a tau trick. So you consider this particular thing, which maps zero to z. And then consider f tau xi. Plug in xi is equal to minus z naught to get, well, or minus z, to get that z f prime of z over f of z is exactly equal to r of 1 minus r squared f tau of minus z. And then we can use Gross theorem to get this bounds. Okay, so this is just, again, wanted to show you this proof to see that sometimes in some of these distortion estimates you need. Okay, so next sort of distortion theorem will be concerned with a Bloch space. So this is André Bloch, a French mathematician of very interesting fate. So all his theorems were proven and all the incredible spaces that we'll see in a moment were introduced while he was in mental asylum after killing his family. And so mathematics sometimes will propagate interesting ways. So this is a very important definition of Bloch norm. Again, another object which we'll use a lot. So for an analytic function B, this is supremum, not of the derivative. So we don't assume the derivative is finite, but the derivative in multiplied by element of quasi hyper of rather hyperbolic metric 1 minus z squared b prime of z. So technically speaking, this is a semi-norm because constants have zero norm, but you can add I don't know b of zero to make it a norm. And intuitively, Bloch functions with finite Bloch norms are Lipschitz maps from hyperbolic metric to Euclidean metric. So again, because B prime is not bounded, but if you multiply it by element of hyperbolic metric, it is bound. And it's very easy to see that this norm is invariant under automorphisms of the unit disk. So this is an easy computation just because automorphisms preserve hyperbolic metric. And now very important theorem. Which would be easy by now, which is due to Bloch, is that if you are in S, then Bloch norm of log f prime is bounded by 6. And 6 is precise. As I like to say, my life would be so much easier if instead of 6, there would be 1 here. Lots of conjectures I work on my whole life actually would be trivial if it would be 1, but it is 6. The proof is easy. So we just use Bieber-Bach theorem. So we return to our first inequality for Gross, this inequality. Let's apply it here. We simply have that this r f2 prime over f prime is bounded by 6r over 1 minus r squared. And again, this is 2r squared plus 4r. We are pretty generous with replacement of this 6r, but it turns out again to be precise. And why I mentioned that my life would be easier, because there is a univalence criterion, which we wouldn't prove now. That if you have an analytic function with non-zero derivative and Bloch norm of derivative bounded by 1, then f itself is univalent. So there is this factor of six, right? So it's necessary to be for your Bloch norm to be bounded by six for the log derivative. It's sufficient to be bounded by one. And just a restatement of this theorem, very important, is that f prime of z1 over f prime of z2, it's bounded by hyperbolic distance between z1 and z2. For any map in AFD, which is conformal. And again, here, this is actually not needed because, of course, shifts of F, let me actually erase it. Shifts of F don't affect anything. So how do I know this again? Because you can integrate this bound between over the interval from z1 to z2, and over hyperbolic geodesic from z1 to z2. On one hand, you get hyperbolic distance. On the other hand, you get difference of log f prime. You take exponent, and you get this. Okay. Any questions here? So again, the main takeaways from this part are the following, that we have precise distortion bounds on the functions from class S and some distortion bounds on functions of class sigma, and that there is this very important Bloch norm, which essentially Bloch theorem tells us that on each hyperbolic disk at fixed radius, derivative cannot change much multiplicatively. So you can jump up or down only by a fixed factor. Okay. So now let us move on to another very classical subject. And this is Carassiadori convergence. So we'll talk about geometric characterization of convergence in S. And surprisingly, there was a relatively recent development here to this classical thing. I will mention it. Okay, so let omega n be a sequence of simply connected domains, all of them containing some reference point W naught. The kernel of this sequence with respect to W naught is what? It's the point W naught itself. Together with union of all W's such that you can find domain which is subset of all omega n's for large n and which contain both W naught and W. So essentially, kernel consists of point W naught itself and all the points of which you can join to W naught by open subsets which are in all the domains. So it's very easy to see, so if there are no such W's, of course, kernel is just point W naught. Otherwise, it's very easy to see that this kernel is a domain which contains W naught. And we denote this domain by omega. Now, the first definition of Carassiadori convergence looks totally counterintuitive, And so this is kernel convergence. We say that this sequence omega n w naught converges in kernel sense to omega w naught if for every subsequence, kernel of the subsequence is still omega. So kernel of subsequence, of course, is large because you have to be subset of less domains. But you converge in kernel sense if by taking a subsequence, you cannot make the limit larger. So this is definition of kernel convergence. And so one of the important examples is the following situation. Suppose that you have monotone sequence, monotone increasing sequence, decreasing as a sequence. And omega is a component of the interior containing W naught. So you take interior of the intersection. Then I claim that omega and kernel converges to omega if omega is not empty. And if omega is empty, then omega and kernel converges to just W naught. Okay, so this is what kernel convergence is. So first let us observe that by monotonicity, this thing that I discussed, that kernel of subsequence is bigger, could be bigger than kernel of sequence, that's not relevant here, because kernel of subsequence is again the same as kernel of the whole sequence, because you know, by monotonicity, if you contain in all the members of the subsequence, you contain in all the members of sequence. So we need to show that this guy is a kernel of our sequence. First of all, it's very easy to see that omega is subset of the kernel because you can always take H, this H, remember, to be just omega. It's good, it's subset of everything. On the other hand, if your guy is in kernel, then you can find H, which is subset of all omega n's. Here again, if you subset of one omega n, you subset of all small n's. By monotonicity. So H is subset of intersection of omega n. H is open, W naught is in H, it means that H is subset of omega. So W belongs to omega. If W is in the kernel, then since any such H is subset of omega, we are done. Okay, so let me just show two examples here. So let me start with this very classical thing. So we look at this domain omega n, which is complex plane, minus this lines to minus 1 over n, and from 1 over n to infinity. Then what happens is the following. Omega n with respect to I, it converges to the upper half plane. Think about it. The points which are, you cannot join I by an open set to anything below, because eventually any open set would be squished by these two intervals. But you can obviously join to anything above, well, or you can just use our discussion. By these guys, omega n with respect to minus I, they would converge to the lower half plane. again by our discussion, because the component of the intersection would be a lower half plane. Okay, now let us look at this picture, which is very similar. Omega n with W1 would converge to the this disk centered in W1, or this component. Omega n with respect to W2 would converge to this disk centered with W2. So reference point is very important. That's the point of these two examples. Again, you take the so just to explain, so these two domains, they were decreasing, and we were just decreasing the size of this bridge, the width of the bridge. So at the end step is one over n. Okay, so this is kernel convergence. Now the next definition, in my opinion, is much easier to swallow. So, and this is the following. So suppose that omega n kernel converges to omega, and you have a point, well, as usual, so it's all respect to this point W naught. Then this happens if and only if the following two conditions are satisfied. First, for every compact K in omega, K is subset of omega n for every n bigger than n. So every compact K would be eventually swallowed by omega n. And second, for every point of the boundary, the exist point, you can find the sequence of points from the boundaries of omega n such that Cn converges to C. So n2 can be, of course, restated as distance from C to boundary of omega n tends to zero for every C in the boundary of omega. Okay, so let us at least start proving equivalency. So let us first prove that kernel convergence implies conditions one and two. So suppose that omega n kernel converges to K, to omega, and K is compact subset of omega. So what does it mean? It means that for every X and K, there exists HK domain such that X belongs to HK, and HK, remember, joins HKHX, and W naught belongs to HX. Now HX bound K, so K is compact, so we can select finitely many of them, and their subset omega n for large enough omega n, which means that K is indeed in omega n, so K is subset of omega. K is subset of omega n for large enough. Now, so we don't need this. So this implies condition one. Now condition two, that for every C in the boundary, we have a sequence N. Assume that there is no such sequence. So then there exists subsequence NK and some epsilon that B of C epsilon doesn't intersect the boundary of omega nk. Now take any W which is in this disk intersect with omega. Omega is kernel, so W is subset of H, subset of omega n for large n. But it means that H union with B of C epsilon is connected open set, so it's subset of omega nk for large k, so C belongs to kernel of omega nk. But it means that kernel of omega nk is not the same as kernel of omega n, which was omega. Because C did not belong to kernel omega n. It was, in fact, the boundary. So we get a contradiction. And we'll prove the other direction after we return from a break. So we'll reconvene at noon Toronto time. Thank you.